Thank you, Christina, and I echo everyone's thanks to all of you for coming today. I also want to thank Mark, James, Romeo, and Latoya for being here for this conversation, and the other participants who were also a part of Sean's project, Primitive Games. And of course, thank Sean for being here to reflect on this experience. So I think mostly this will be a conversation between Sean and you all, but I just want to set up a little bit of a framework and give some more background on this project from Sean's perspective. So Sean, I thought maybe you could give us some information about how you came to develop this project, Primitive Games, at the Guggenheim Museum, and maybe also following up, like how this fits within your current role and practice as an artist.
Well, I will first admit that while this is a reflection of last night is a complete blur. So I may not have much brilliance to offer in terms of what happened last night, but I can talk about how we arrived at this point. But first, I would like to say thank you to you, Anna, for taking this ride with me.
Thank you.
You're at the heart of this project, and it could not have been done without your diligence and work. And I also would like to thank all of the participants and our guests tonight to my right, without whose trust this entire process would not be possible. And so, in keeping with that trust, I will say that there are representatives from each of the four groups last night, namely military veterans, recreational users of firearms, law enforcement officers, and finally, citizens impacted by street violence. But I refuse to explicitly name any of these individuals as part of one group affiliation or another. And I ask that you don't ask either. It is part of their investment and commitment to the process that last night was possible, that secrecy was absolutely integral into the ways in which they would be forced to engage with one another through only their perceptions of who their opponents were. And it's equally important that as an audience, an extension of last night, that you continue to question your perceptions of who is who. And so that's where we are. This project, to answer your question, was most influenced by two ongoing works in the last few years. One entitled I Can't Breathe, which was staged as a self-defense course, which would then transition into a performative thing without the participants realizing it. And a second named Mirror Echo Tilt, which was a collaboration, is a collaboration with two other brilliant artists, Melanie Crean, who's in the room, and Sable Smith, which is an ongoing workshop formatted project with formerly incarcerated individuals that leads to a film production and guided me into a process where I'm now conducting a diversion program for youth that have just been arrested in the downtown Brooklyn Criminal Court. In both cases, two things were crucial. As invested in a process of embodiment, it was an attempt to move strangers closer together. And secondly, it was a way of helping individuals get to a place where they would hold on to their stories or their trauma in a different way. And it's my argument that so much of that needs to take place without words, because language is precisely what gets in the way when we try to communicate with one another. And so that is where Primitive Games started. But if I want to answer that question, honestly, I have to say that my artistic practice only plays a slight role in why I find myself conducting this type of work. The negotiation and the maneuvering between communities is something that I've found myself uncomfortably having to do my entire life, inside and outside my artistic practice. It's the only thing that I know to do. And so I don't think it's an accident that works like I Can't Breathe and the Mirror Echo Tilt brought me to a place where I've gained access to power, whether that's law enforcement, judge, police officers, what it might be, whatever it might be. And it's something that I feel, while it is draining and uncomfortable as an individual, that it's just something that I have to own. And it's a voice, it's a code switching, it's a maneuvering, physically, mentally, emotionally, that I has just become my responsibility.
Thank you. So it was great to see that many of the people in the audience actually attended the performance last night, and I'm so glad you were able to see it. But what many people may not be so familiar with is that this project actually, the performance was a culmination of a months-long project that involved a series of workshops with these four communities that you've brought together. So could you tell us more about the process of the workshops and how that factored into the final performance that we saw last night? And then maybe we can hear from the participants.
Absolutely. So the workshops were conducted separately with each group. And actually, just to give you some insight into the process, what was important is that I removed the performance as an outcome from the process entirely. We did not really talk about what the outcome would be, because it was much more important to not think about the performative qualities of what might happen, but instead to think about, as group affiliation and as individuals, what are the ways that we've already experienced conflict? And so through a series of exercises, really movement-based and storytelling-based, what I really wanted, what I was most compelled to do, is ask these individuals, how is it that their bodies already activate when faced with confrontation? Now, the mechanics of that, the body language that emerges from a veteran versus an officer versus someone that experienced violence in the streets versus someone who feels entitled to hold the power of a firearm, that manifests dramatically different in those bodies. But on an individual basis, that trauma of opposition, resistance, conflict is also something that emerges in very unconscious ways. And that was the process, that was the starting point. To be more attuned to the ways that our bodies move in times of confrontation, so that we could more carefully read posturing and gestures in someone that we're perceiving to be other. And so we were invested in this process of really digging into difficult territory, to own it, to hold it, so that we can better understand that the way we perceive someone in front of us is informed by all the baggage we bring to the table that very moment. And so, by extension, really what I would love to ask you all is, how do you feel the workshop process influenced your approach and or experience of the performance? We open it up to all of you, yeah.
For me, one of the key things that you said was letting go of the performance aspect and the outcome and really zeroing into reading not only our own inbred kind of ways of reacting physically, but most importantly, to zero in on what we were getting from our opponent. So that was very, very helpful to me.
Anil, yeah, please.
No, actually, it was learning to read the concept that's trying to be put forth by the individual next to you that we were studying with. People are in contact with their emotions or thought process verbally, but very few people are in contact with their emotions and how to express it, or are aware of how they express themselves in moments that are emotionally charged or come from that place. The workshops opened up eyes. You know, one process that we used was to tell a deep story of something that happened traumatic in our life. And that really, sharing that with other people in the workshop unlocked floodgates of emotions. And things that you weren't feeling prior to, they were brought to the surface, and then we acted on them. And learning the interpretation, learning the how to read body language was the most important take from it. We react as we react, but how we interpret what's coming before us is really something that a lot of people overlook.
Yeah.
You know, as opposed to formulating an opinion and just putting it out there, learning how to respond to the stimuli right in front of them without words being said.
Yeah.
And I thank you for that.
Also, I found that trust was a really important part of this process, and you know, I credit Shaun with creating a safe space for us to be vulnerable. And some for me, just a little personal story that happened in the workshop with me was we were dealing with Shaun asked us to think of someone in our life that we were in opposition to, and he paired us off with a person, and we were to tell that person a story. And then later, that person would come back to the group and select one gesture from the story that they heard. And the story that I happened to tell was about me being in opposition to my mother, and I was in a very abusive relationship that I always made light of and kind of laughed about it and tried to joke about it. Oh, she would do this and she would do that. And when the person who told the story to the group, when he got into a position, he got a gesture in him that just made me lose it. I read in his body what I had experienced, that he knew, when I was telling him this story, he understood what I must have been feeling and going through, and when he told that story, it was just very powerful, and that was a very powerful thing for me.
Yeah, just piggybacking what this brother said, it has, what I've learned and taken from the workshops is, you know, not to just judge people for whatever they bring in front of you, you know, to actually get to know the person and take the time out to see what their struggle was and what their struggle is and whatever it is that they're going through. And, you know, shedding light, honestly, and enlightening them on whatever it is that needs to be told, basically.
So the workshop was very mind-opening to me. What I think the workshop invoked in me is just to see more of what we bring to the table when we deal with individuals, whether they're opposing us or not, based on honesty. I realized that it's just like two emotions that we usually are taught to deal with, which is fear and love. And the workshop, that's what I thought in the beginning, but at the end, the workshop, I really thought that it brought out that we were really just taught about fear. And if you really think about it, we're taught to be fearful our whole lives. We have to be fearful so we can succeed, because the best always win. We have to be fearful not to fail. We have to be fearful to be number one. And we think that that is being strong. And from the workshop, when someone was opposing me, I was wondering, why were they fearful? Fearful of what? Why are you fearing me? We are all the same. So I didn't think that we have truly as a race learned how to love, because we have never really taught what pure, true love is. And that workshop, just seeing piggybacking on the stories. When you tell a story that have impacted you and someone have to just make one gesture and that one gesture tells your story, you really see, okay, this person listened, not out of fear, but out of love to try and help you cope with that, because you think that you've coped with your past, but you really haven't, because other emotions come up. And then you have to be honest with that and tell it through a gesture and not words. Because words are just words. But when you look into the eyes and you look into movement and body, that really tells a whole lot more.
The other thing, last night in the performance, other people remarked and telling, giving feedback about the performance, is that they noticed how so many of us were locked in with our eyes into one another, which we got in the workshop, because you had, in order to read somebody, not only do you have to read their body language, which is most important, but you also have to read their soul, if you will, and that eye contact was incredibly important. And I noticed that last night, that that throughout the performance last night, whenever I was engaged with somebody, that's the first place I looked at was their eyes, to see where they were coming from, what they were offering me, and then I looked at, then I tried to read their body.
I found that to be the most surprising and uncomfortable part of it for me, because and that's coming from the person that led the entire process. And yet, the very first person I paired with, who was part of the veterans group, I came charging at this dude, and he gave me nothing but his eyes. He just stared at me with such openness, and he refused to give me anything else but just right here. And it forced me up, because I had everything existing in my body. I was like, okay, let's do this. And he was like, no, from here to here. And from that moment on, from that connection, I knew that I had to lock eyes with everyone else from that moment on. So the process had a way of even jarring me out of my own body, out of my own perceptions. And I guess the way I want to frame this question is, what surprised you all most out of the performance? Or was there a moment that really comes up for you?
When we did the workshops, you gave us structure, and you gave us the ability to acknowledge, to read, to express. The groups that we were in, we were separated per group. And all we knew was the commonality of the subject matter. Once you put in all the filters and then we laid down the topic, I think the eye contact was so strong, because that was the initial response when everybody was focused. And then what they thought it was almost like a tablecloth being pulled out from underneath the table. Mm-hmm. You know, and what? That's, for me personally, the subject matter was very strong. And I had to take that pause and reflect and then express. When you're running across somebody that's a complete stranger, that not even perceived notion, but we all know that we're all from different walks of life, but there was a commonality that was found. A lot of the expression that went on, as you would see to the right and to the left, you were focused on your pair, but it's funny to see that when words are excluded, the commonality of man and how they express themselves comes to the top. Mm. Mm-hmm. They're forced to, because words, based on vocabulary, the vocabulary that was used there last night, everybody knew what the definition of, but they took different things from it. But the eye contact was the primary. Mm-hmm. Was it, some people have mentioned, you know, eyes are the windows to the soul. Mm-hmm. So before you can have that conversation, you have to look into that reflection. Yeah. And that's what I took.
I was surprised. I was not prepared for the none of us knew what the subject matter was going to be last night, and I was not prepared at all for how emotionally intense it would be, especially in light of what we're going through as a society right now. And I guess what surprised me the most was how I felt that in my body. And as Shaun asked us, as we continued throughout the evening, to always be remembering those filters that he gave us around the subject matter that we were dealing with, which is, for at least for me personally, has me pretty much traumatized about what's going on out there. And I carried that with me throughout the evening. And I was just so surprised about how much I felt that physically in my body in every encounter that I had last night.
Right on. Kind of what surprised me was the fact that I didn't freeze up first and foremost, you know. But sometimes myself, I caught myself being stuck, you know, locked in with that one person. And then I get so deep into my thought that, you know, somebody will have to come around and tap me and, you know, bring me back to reality, because it was so real. And I was being so real with myself that, like these brothers said, you know, sometimes you go back to that traumatization and you relive those moments mentally. Mm. You know, so to snap back from that is kind of hard, and that is what really surprised me.
I think what's surprising to me, we knew that we had the different groups, but we did not know who the different groups were until we walked on stage. And when you gave us the filters, just to think that even though we were from different groups, we had that commonality with something, that we're on the same team. And then when you locked in with someone, you're just wondering, how can we be on the same team? We're different. We belong to a different group. Right. How do we have anything in common? Because we tend to group ourselves, whether that's by race, religion, class, socioeconomic status, whatever it is. We tend to group ourselves with that group, and we don't think we have anything in common with anyone else outside of that group. We live in our own little bubble. So to see that and to feel that, it was very interesting to me.
I feel like I should name the beginning of the performance for those of you that were not here. But the ceremony of how the four groups, thank you for that image. Let's go back to that image. One more. The ways in which four very distinct group affiliations were divided into two teams essentially was the core of the project. I offered a series of questions which clarified the issue to be debated between these four groups, that being gun violence. I'm not sure if you guys ever realized, but throughout this entire process, dating back to January, I never said the word gun nor violence.
Not at all.
In any of the workshops.
Not once.
So it was only when these questions emerged that the ways in which they would be divided would occur, but also, again, that prompt, that filter into which they perceive one another would be placed in the middle of the room. And those questions would started with sentiments such as, do you feel like you are a good person? To, do you fear for your community? And then escalated to questions such as, do you feel American? Do you feel you will be alive in the next 10 years? And culminated with questions such as, have you ever witnessed someone die? Or finally, have you ever lost someone to gun violence? And so it's in those questions, which I asked them to internalize in both mind, body, and spirit, that their engagement would be defined. And so I think it would be doing a disservice to this conversation, since we are returning to words, if I were not to ask, have you felt whether in your mind, body, or spirit, have you felt a shift to your relationship to gun violence? Is there ways in which by engaging people that, at least on paper, would exist on the other side of the debate, that you're thinking about debate specifically around gun violence differently?
I think it's more of an end result of an affirmation. But a wider view of the subject. Mm. You know, there's no black or white, there's a lot of gray.
Yeah.
And usually people only see one shade of gray. What was allowed to be put before us was the full spectrum. You know, from, I remember the old designer markers from gray 0 to gray 10, you know. So we went through all of that through the workshop with people that we knew were of like mind. When we were all thrown into the mix together, and then we were filtered, it put a little thought in the back of your head that the person standing next to you is more akin to you than you thought.
Right.
And the workshops helped us to physically vocalize what we've internalized. Mm-hmm. Because more than likely, today's society is it's parroting subject matter as opposed to finding opinion. And it's a lot easier with the grind that goes on a daily basis for you just to skim the surface. This we had to go below, much below the surface.
Right.
You know, how to find it and how to express it and how to have make it have purpose behind it. Because purpose was communication. And to see what the responses would be to that communication.
Yeah.
That was great.
I don't know that it's going to help me change much my reaction and perception of gun violence. It's such a traumatic part of our lives right now, especially if you have children in school or grandchildren. It's hard not to get into your group about where you stand on that. But what has helped me tremendously is just being able to get out of my head and focus more on who that person is I'm in opposition with. You know, I'm trying to tone down in general, not so much as a little bit as a result of the workshop, and I'm trying to tone down myself on social media and on immediately retreating to my positions, my political positions, whatever. And because I found it so helpful. I know that some of the people in the workshop that I was with last night, I didn't know who they were before, but afterwards in speaking with them, finding what group they were affiliated with, and how I reacted with them out on the floor was so much different than I thought I would react with that person in real life. Hopefully, in the future, before I jump in my head to my position, if I encounter someone who's opposed to me about gun violence, I'll take you know a little more time to read that person and to see who that person is, rather than jump into my head about my predisposed position on it.
No comment.
So I don't know if my opinion would change about gun violence, but I do know that my opinion about others who, whatever it is that they feel, I'm hoping that I have an open mind and I can look into their body language, their gestures, and just try and figure out why they feel and how they feel before I can formulate an opinion about them, mm-hmm. regardless of what their stance may be or what my stance may be. So I'm willing to be open to that.
We only have a few moments here, and I thought it was important to name the thing, particularly because we went through this entire ride together. And you know, where I started this project, it's never been my objective to be in the middle of a situation in which I'm asking anyone to abandon their beliefs. Just the opposite. I think it's absolutely important to be entrenched into your belief systems. I'll get to that in a second. I was the only individual that became the vessel for all four groups, thoughts, feelings, traumas, belief systems. And one thing that I keep on revisiting is our very first conversation before the workshops even started. Separate conversations at the various home turfs of each group affiliation. And I asked each group, can you please name a value that ties this group together? And without naming who said what, I will say that words like loyalty, respect, duty, responsibility, what else am I forgetting, Anna?
Unity.
All words that I would say everybody in this room believes in. And yet, I could not comfortably sit in that room with any of these groups and say, I believe in what you're saying to me. And this is where it gets down to. There's a way, and we're all fall victim to this. There's a way in which we take a value that we firmly believe in, a value that is universally a beautiful thing, and translate that into a belief system that gives us security, that gives us some sort of worldview that is comfortable. And in that translation from value to belief system, in order to hold on to something that we think we know, it necessarily forces us to exclude everyone else. So if you center duty or unity or loyalty, I bet there's no one on this panel that will say they're against those words. But somehow, in terms of gun violence, and I want to say that the issue is gun violence, not gun control. Gun control is a posed solution. Gun violence is the issue that I think everyone in this room would agree is a problem. It's somewhere in that translation that we forget that. It's somewhere in that translation from value to belief system that we lose the fact that debate, that our sides of an argument, which we shouldn't abandon necessarily, still can arrive all of us to a point where we say, where we name a thing that is not only good for us, but good for everyone. And that is precisely what we've lost. And as precisely in terms of failure of communication, where debate as an art form has been forgotten, has completely devolved into a primitive game. And so what I was simply attempting to do, and I think what you all have eloquently described, is that to lose oneself is not necessary to meet someone else halfway. To give up a little power is. To give up a little of our stubbornness is absolutely necessary.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But you can be your own identity. And if you believe in community, the real sense of community, then you will locate the one thing that is a commonality. And sometimes, unfortunately, that's fear. And if fear is not enough to move us to a place, not of agreement, but consensus, then what the fuck are we doing? And I think what was most powerful as the person that could actually identify everyone in that room, in that arena, is that I also lost track of who was who. Because of that body language, because of that commonality. And it's the truth that's conveyed through the body that I think will get us to a place where we might take a moment to listen and understand that our affiliations don't fully identify us, and that we can still believe in our own identities and our value systems and understand that our belief systems might meet somewhere.
And I think that you're onto something, because at the end of the performance, magically, we all came together as one in a circle and united. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that wasn't scripted at all. So at some point, we realized that we have to put our biases aside, we have to put our pride aside, and we have to come together as one in order to control this thing called mm-hmm. gun violence, to make it better.
I think one of the greatest things from the piece itself, as far as the participants are concerned, myself, is to learn how to take a gut reaction and express it. Yeah. Because that's what we usually go by. You know, we say, go by your gut reaction. Mm-hmm. A lot of us have a lot of guts. Mm-hmm. You know, and we all reacted body language. We expressed ourselves quite similarly at times on subject matter that would put other people on opposite sides of the fence. Right. But instead of being on opposite sides of the fence, we were the fence.
Right. Mm.
And it was for everybody else to draw their conclusions.
Yeah. Right.
Unfortunately, words sometimes get lost in translation.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know? But the rawness of the gut expression was so primary that everyone was able to take something from it and incorporate it into themselves. And that's why, on the occasion that I had a chance to look at the audience, you could see that they were as fixed on the subject matter, at the people participating, mm-hmm. as the participants.
Yeah. Right. I just think that you've given us a chance to express ourselves without you being politically correct. Mm-hmm. And that in itself was pure. And I think that's what the audience connected with. And that is what was needed.
Just thank you.
Thank you all so much. Thanks.